Okay, so there'll be, I know there's a little warm up. Anyway, we're getting going, you know, semester, and we have fun. Right. I want to say, so we'll have an assignment, I'll send out an assignment later today. And it'll be about these branching networks things, right? And so we'll get into some more details here. But I'm not sure if I'll be able to get through everything you need to do that assignment, so the due date will be a little variable. Anyway. No office hours today. We'll start that next week. Cool. Any questions about things? I feel like I should do what he, yeah. No, he was a bad, it was not very nice. Favoring the one person, that was terrible. Okay. Okay, so we talked about, so this is this kind of basic idea. We have basins within basins, right? So there's every point, there's this little basin, and you can think about this, this could be part of, right, this could be an artery servicing some part of the body. Of course, there is this other network that's bringing all the blood back, but that's sort of the same idea. And out here, we have all these little capillaries, or how we try to say that. So, you know, various other kinds of versions of these things. Okay, so this is where we're getting to. Let me just get these variables again. So there's a characteristic length, right? We sort of put a rectangle around it. There's this width, which we'll call L perpendicular. L parallel, we'll just put L for that. So that's the length of the thing, sort of the length. And then there's going to be an area, which is just as you look down on it. Now, of course, there's relief here, right? The mountains and things. But we're going to be thinking about ones at continent scale. And at a continent scale, things are pretty flat, right? Mount Everest is tall, but not that tall. It's just little bumps. If you use Strava, there's a thing called Relive now, which is a website that uploads your training thing. And have you ever seen this? And you can see, this is a very important detour, but you can it'll trace out your little run or your bike ride or whatever it is. And it's always really disappointing because you may have gone up some enormous hill, but it just looks so flat, you know, because that's, you just want it to like, just let's pretend, you know, like make it by 10 in that direction. anyway, so yeah, so there are these relationships connecting them, these scaling laws. And let's see, some of these stories we have. Okay, Hack's Law. So this is 1957. This is based on people going out and looking and measuring things, looking at things and measuring things, which is all good. That's that paper here. And it was by, the paper was by Hack, presumably 40 graduate students who were never mentioned, you know, in the old way that people did things, which is still done in the social sciences and other fields. Anyway, so it became known as Hack's Law, and it was this relationship, so it was scaling fans, right? We talked a lot about scaling in pucks. That exponent h, this little h, we'll keep this somewhere, it's sort of purportedly above a half, right? So a half is the dimensional analysis simple scaling, right? This is meters squared, this is meters, or whatever you want, to the power of a half. So that would make sense, right? So it's growing isometrically. But it's, the claim was, at least for this small patch that Hack looked at, that it actually was scaling allometrically, which is to use that word again, and that would mean, when you think about this, that these bigger basins are kind of thinner relatively. All right. You can put a few other pieces together. There's this one. So this is the little curly L, which in, for LaTeX fans, that's a slash E double L. That makes that one, yeah. And that is scaling as the overall Euclidean length of the basin, right? Euclidean length of the basin, whoop, and this is the wiggly length. That's scaling as L, capital L to the power of D. So that means it's a little bit fractally, right? So it's scaling a little bit faster. It's superlinear, but very, very barely, right? This is very weak scaling, possibly not something to rest on. But it just seems to be, you know, people I've seen that. It's a little bit hard to measure, to be honest. What I mean is a little bit hard to be sure. If you've got, you know, if it's 1.05, to be really sure, that's statistically not one. As we've talked about, people argue a lot about scaling, right? Okay. There was just a little Twitter outburst between some of the people's names that I've mentioned. I don't know if any of you probably didn't see this, but Duncan Watts was on there, and Vespignani, and Clausette, and they were all having a little bit of a argy-bargy with each other about whose scaling laws are the best, and, you know. scale-free networks, whether they're real or not, and stuff. Oh my God. Anyway, so really not good. Twitter fights between academics. Great. Okay, so, and then there's another scaling. You put these things together, right? So we've got a little L here and here, the basin area here, and the overall length here. We can just equate these things and then take the exponent of the other side, and we'll have the overall length. And this is a bit odd the way it's been expressed traditionally. Length as a function of area, it should be kind of the other way around, just the way it's been done. So I'm trying to connect the literature. So this is the Euclidean length, which is a bit of a rough thing to measure again, but scales as area to the h over d. So that's going to be a new, we'll just call it 1 over d, because that would sort of make sense if we put that big D here. If that was a 2, that would be sensible, right? Area to, should scale as length squared. But again, sort of fitting with this elongation thing, it's sort of supposedly less than 2. We're going to show that at the larger scales that doesn't seem to be the case, but it's still an interesting business. Okay, so turns out that were 3 laws. There's a whole bunch of them that people have been sort of uncovering over a long period of time. You know, I could put citations in for that too, just because that would be, yep. This is the sort of thing that happens. And so we've talked about some other kinds of examples like this, but this is a very, it's true in biology, it's true in physics, and so they have all their names, and they're all different, and maybe not, right? So a game will be to try and connect these things to each other, right? So these could all be entirely independent. We've already seen that, on the previous slide, we had, sort of a third law connected, derived from the first two, right? So this is this scaling of basin areas, deriving it from this one. So we know, for example, D is, what do I have? D would have been, little d over h, right? So that's a typical game, and we call these things scaling relations, where there are connections that are just simple algebraic ones, right? That's just a ratio. This d is equal to the little d divided by h. So we should be able to build up a table of those things, like this, and eventually find out that there are 2, 3, 4 independent exponents. Right, that's it, and this, here it's framed in terms of river networks. This is true for blood networks as well, and of course, more generally, it could be about, fluids, it could be whatever you want, right? So lots of systems that have scalings, there are these interconnected relationships. But these were, these all come from separate papers, people discovering, measuring things in different ways. This is, for example, like the sum of all the stream lengths, sort of a reasonable idea, like I'm gonna go to this thing, find them all, and I'm just going to sum up, I'm going to sort of measure the length of every river independently, break them all up into little pieces, add it all up, and see how that scales with area. And sort of sitting in here, and so what we're going to talk about are these guys, mostly today, and then we'll get to Tokunaga's law. These are really interesting, detailed structure pieces. I do think, to be honest, there has to be a better way to do all of this. And maybe you can think about that as we go through it. But whatever you come up with will still connect to all of these things. Let's see, so, and of course we have these power laws, right? So this is again, if you just randomly select a point in a basin or in a big landscape, the probability that it has, that there's a basin with an area A or and a mainstream length L has a power law decay. And so all of this fits together, power laws. The paper by Clausette, actually, it just came out, was the title of something like Scale-Free Networks are, I think, maybe it's just are rare in nature, right? Something like that. So that's, fighting words, right? And it's one of those things where I've got a whole bunch of networks that are really small, and of course they're not going to be statistically kind of anything, right? It has that whole business of, I think, when I present scaling, power law size distributions you guys start with, 3 orders of magnitude is sort of this great thing to have in both dimensions. You want some, and that's just a rule of thumb, but it's like, anyway. Oh, that's so funny. All right, so of course there are these original papers, and then there are all these measurements, yeah? And, science is a little funny, so people tend to measure things that are similar to what the smart person measured before, there's real history of that. A famous example of that is, I think it's the ratio of electron charge to the mass. Does anyone know about this one? This is the early 1900s, and someone just got it wrong. Very famous character, I can't remember, I need to get this story straight. But basically, someone does it empirically, you know, experimentally, and gets it wrong. They're just off. And there's a theoretical estimate, which is right. And then over time, what you see is all these new measurements slowly move towards the theoretical one, right? Because they're like looking at that big spark, right? So they're like, you know, I almost got what they got, but it's a little bit on this side, a little bit, it drifts towards the true one. And that's physics, right? Social phenomena. Okay. Anyway, so there's a whole batch of these guys, and then, you know, and of course these plus or minuses are a little funny, but they're interesting numbers. They're not all, you know, a half and two and three, you know, things that we could just say come from sort of obvious ways things fit together. Oh, lights. Or do you want to sort of be in a cozy, sleepy, warm place? Like my cat. Haven't talked about the cat enough. Okay, so okay, so we're going to find out how these things are connected, find the most fundamental descriptions, like, okay, we only need these three laws, everything else comes from it, we can focus on those, so then when we go to a real data set, we're going to measure those three things, and, or whatever it is, and then we'll measure it over here, and then we'll sort of collect a whole bunch, and we'll say, okay, if we want to have some, you know, our grand theory for how all of this appears, you know, we need to be able to produce those relationships, right? So this is... Now this has been around for a long time, but I still feel it's kind of, it kind of stopped at some point. So we've got a great description, and there are a bunch of theories out there, and lovely little fun models on computers, but, you know, it's still sort of waiting. Anyway, but it's very, still very important to understand how these things fit together, and it's quite beautiful. And as I said, the word for these is that, you know, branching networks in nature are not pure hierarchies, they're these kind of mixed hierarchical structures. I have a point. Okay. Orders of streams. Got its own tarot card. Okay. Cool. So. Okay. So as I said, Horton the other day, Robert Horton, so famous hydrologist, this is sort of the first, as I understand it, someone sort of coming up with a way of quantifying recursive structures, fractal structures. There's an improvement by Strahler, so there are these three pieces that go together. We'll get to that. It turns out that they could be collapsed again, which comes like, I guess I was sort of involved in that, but that's many, many, many years later. Okay, so you'll see this. Horton-Strahler stream ordering, and that this will be used when people are talking about blood networks. They'll say we're using Horton stream ordering or something. So let's just go through. It's a simple idea. You can think of it in different ways, and I'll sort of point that out, but you can think of this sort of iterative trimming to order these things, because we want to sort of, I mean, one thing we want to say is like, you know, you could go here and measure the width of this thing and sort of have this very fine-grained idea of it. The problem with, say, that probability distribution that decays like a Powell law, it doesn't tell you, if you just handed that, right, there's a probability of stream length decays like a Powell law, it doesn't tell you anything about how these things fit together, right, there's no structure in that thing. So we need to sort of understand, like, these are kind of clearly small ones, so we want to signify that by some sort of labeling, some sort of quantification of that. And then, you know, and there's a bigger main one in the middle. So how do we do that? So the blood network version would be a capillary, but, you know, out in actual landscape, you can go and say this is where a channel starts, right? You can actually do that. And if you have fine enough topographic data, then you can do similar sorts of things. So you can do it by remote sensing. Once again, every science changes, right, as you go from data scarce to data rich, right? So once you get to remote sensing, then you can do all sorts of interesting things and potentially bad things. But, you know, that's what's happened to many, many sciences now. Okay, so so a channel head, so we have that. And then we'll talk about a source stream. These are just sort of words. So a source stream will be one that starts with a, you know, you go to the landscape, this would be kind of smooth or messy or whatever it is, but there's no well-defined channels in here, and water's sort of coming in, and then boom, there's clearly like flow here, right? So we'll call that, these little dashed ones will be source streams, and then we want to say, well, where they hit each other, that's going to be a next kind of stream, that's a different stream. And so we're going to use omega to label stream order. So that's this little guy is going to appear a lot. And you know, so this is a funny thing to think about. So these are, I'll show you how to do it. But these will be order one streams. These little dash ones. These will be order two ones, and this will be an order three one in the middle, and then that would keep going, keep going, keep going. You can see this is kind of growing exponentially, right? So these are very small. The next, this sort of factors getting bigger and bigger by a certain factor. So you don't have order 53 networks, right? So depending on your resolution, the Mississippi might be an order 13 or 14 stream because these things grow exponentially. Laura? Yeah, so that's right. So that's going to be this mixed hierarchy thing, and I'll, you know, we'll get it in the next plots. But these are order ones, and I'm just, this is a little bit thicker if you can see it. This is an order three, and we'll get it on the next slides. But yeah, exactly, right? So this is this mixed hierarchy idea. So even whatever the largest order is in the network, it will have order ones and twos and threes. And this is this work by Tokunaga that came later, that where he showed this actually a really nice structure there. So it's quite beautiful how all this works, I have to say. That might be somewhat limited in blood networks, but it's actually still broadly true, right? That there are, yeah. Okay, I'm putting all the things up. Okay, so we're gonna start with this and say, let's label all of these obvious incipient streams, right? These ones that clearly have a starting point. We're gonna label them as order one. And then we'll trim them off, right? So you just take your thing, you trim them off. So now we're left with this picture. And then we'll just do it again, right? So it's a recursive iterative thing. These will be now, these look like our new order one ones, but we'll call them order two because we've taken a step. And then we'll trim them off. And we'll be left with this one, right? So this will be order three. And then we just keep going and keep going and keep going. All right, so that's one way to think about it. You can see that as a result of how this works, that just as you say, right, so order ones can be absorbed, so we'll sort of use that language, it'll be absorbed by an order three here. That's an order one. But there are all these order ones that make, they hit each other, right? So it's an order one hitting an order one, and that makes an order two. So that's a repeated kind of structure. Now, of course, this is presuming you have a network that just has bifurcations in it, which is fair, right? Just river forks. This is a bit confusing. Like, so in Pittsburgh, which I should understand, my wife's from there. So the three rivers thing, is it just because there are three names? But it's a fork, right? It's not like there are three rivers that hit each other. Because that seems like sort of a weird geomorphology thing, but it's actually just, yeah. Right. They just change the names. Oh, so it's really two rivers with another. I think it's in China. There are three very large rivers that really do actually kind of parallel each other. It's strange. It's sort of a strange structure, but generally, you know, this sort of thing happens. All right. So this iterative thing, and that's not actually necessarily how it was approached from or sort of described in the first place, and I'll describe it in a different way. But you can see what it means is that, you actually need the, you can imagine these two hit each other. You can think of it as like they then turn into an order two, or they make an order two. So an order two starts because two order ones hit each other, and that's the same up here at the next level, right? So this order three is starting because two order twos have hit each other. So fair enough. So you need, for every order omega one, you're going to have two order omega minus one streams that have hit each other to start it. And then you'll have these side omega, this is say order seven, you'll have side streams of order six, five, four, three, two, one. Yeah? And there'll be more and more of the smaller ones, right? So that's going to have its own little scaling thing as well. And that's Tokunaga's law. Same, okay, so it's not supposed to be a crazy hard thing, but it, some little bit of, what it leads to is just a little bit of counting sort of stuff, right? Some sums and things, trying to figure out some stuff, which is fun. Fun combinatorics, people. Yes?
Would you need to define the size of, like, an order one in order to continue
right.
to define the sizes of the higher
Yeah, so now we've got labels and we can say, what's the average length of an order? 3-1, right? And so there will be two parts to it. One is, this is a stream segment. We just go to where it sort of stops. Or we could go all the way up, like you would sort of if you're in a boat and you're just trying to take the, you know, you take the main river as you come to every fork, you go up the main river. So that will be our little, that little curly L. So we have those measures, and then there's the area, right? So that's all still there as well. But of course, it's distributional, and that's something we won't really get to too much. I'll tell you about a little, but you know, as you go across a big landscape, there are order threes of all kinds of sizes, and that has its own special kind of distribution. But it's enough to start with to look at the average lengths and the average areas. Is that okay? Yeah, exactly, right? But this way of labeling things gives you a way to then start describing the landscape properly. But I just want you to have in the back of your mind that there could be a better way to do this, right? And so, you might want to start from this end, right? So you might want to start from the A order and kind of go out from there. That feels like a more natural way to label it. And if you have resolution problems, right, this is, you know, there's actually really two order ones here. This is really an order two. So there's a bit of an oddness there in terms of resolution, right? So, and that's very much, I mean, because it's fractal, it doesn't really matter, but there's sort of this unsettling feeling that if you have, you know, back in the 90s, we had satellite data, which was a mile resolution or a kilometer resolution, depending on who was in charge, I suppose. And now it's, you know, 30 centimeters or something, right? It's very refined, yeah. But clearly, when you go from a mile to 30 centimeters, you've changed units, of course, but you will be getting much more structure in here, and, you know, does that affect this description in a way that's upsetting, right? Does this turn out to be an order four, and this is an order three? That's sort of a bit upsetting. Okay. Anyway, see if you can think of a different way to describe the architecture of these networks, right? That's what we're trying to do. What's the architecture of these networks? And we're starting this course with pretty physical things, and we'll move to more madness later on. But we know this thing sits in space. That's good, right? Blood networks are in three dimensions. That's going to matter. This is really in a two-dimensional space. That's going to matter as well. These things, of course, can get deeper, right? As more water comes in, that's less. We've got to keep the whole thing inside the body, so that's going to be something that will matter later on too. All right. So if this is just all you are handed, you would actually say this whole basin is order, and we'll use a capital omega 3, right? So this is just sort of a notation thing. Okay. So this is the Mississippi. This is at this is using a mile resolution data set for the U.S. Of course, Lake Champlain, which is over here, goes to the north, right? Flows out to the north, which is a bit unusual, I think, for most of the drainage in the U.S. is typically going and being consumed by Southern California, Chinatown. Okay. What is that? What it's called? The movie? No, no one knows this movie. Great movie. Yeah, Chinatown, right? Yeah. Right. It's a great, incredible movie, right? But, right, so the LA Water Department went out and bought all the little aqueducts and, or whatever, like the, yeah, aquifers, right? You just see it on a map. You see this little LA water. And there are places that had paddle steamers. What's that place out in the west, east of California? Paddle steamers and so on, right? I mean, and they're just salt plains now, yeah. Very nice gardens in LA, because that's just natural. Okay, so this is only the top orders. Obviously, this would be a big mess if we tried to show them all, but at that resolution, you end up with this one being order 11, the trunk of it, right? And so here we're down in, the bottom of the US. And then these colors, which are just brutalist, green screeny type colors, evolved things since then. This is what you should not do. This is terrible, right? Okay, it's absolutely awful. Yeah. It's like my youngest daughter said, like, she told me the design didn't exist in the 1990s. And I'm like, what are you talking about? And she looked at some websites, I think, from the 1990s. Like, people just didn't know how to do it, like, at all. Like, apparently until the turn of the century, no one could design anything. Like, bridges, anything. houses, whatever. Okay, so it was pretty damning. So, but you can see there's actually a lot of fluctuations here in terms of length, right? So here's a, these are two quite small order 8 ones. So that's something to worry about when we're trying to describe this architecture. We've got a lot of variation, because you'd sort of think the order 8 ones have to be much bigger than the order 7 ones and so on. But actually, it's pretty variable. So this description is going to work very well. It gets a long way, but I still feel like we could do a much better job. Yeah. Anyway. Yeah. So actually, what is hard to see here, so there's the order 11. The order 10, there's an order 10. You can't see it at this resolution, but here are two order 9s. They make an order 10, and it's super short because it runs straight into another order 10 and makes an order 11. So you'll see these repeated connections, right? So here are two order, what are these, 8s? They make a 9. Two order 8s, they make a 9. These are side branches, right? Two order 8s make a 9. And then these two 9s are making a 10 here. That's the start of that one. And this 10 can have side branches of order 8, 9, and 10, and so on. Yeah. Say it again. Yeah, so the order, okay, so that's good. All right, so the order, so this is, so we've made an, you can imagine sort of making, right? So this is two eights making a 9, right? This will only increase when it hits another, only lead to an increase when it hits another 9. So it has to hit another 9. If it hits anything of a higher order, it's absorbed. So you could think of these as sort of generator streams. And then other, so a stream can be a generator if it hits another of its same kind, or it can be absorbed. So here it's this one's absorbed. And here's absorbed, and here is absorbed, right? So this one has three side streams of the, right, these are order, this is order 10, these are order 9. So this order 10 has three side streams that are one order less. So that's pretty a typical kind of number, actually, 2 to 4. But then, and it's not really shown here, if you, as you go down to the next order, you have like a ratio more, maybe twice as many, roughly. And then the next order down would be twice again. So, it's not really showing here, but there's a lot of, it really is sort of clearer here, right? So this is a small one, but this is order 3. It has, this is an order 2 here and order 2 here, so they're absorbed, they're side streams. Here are the two order 2s that make that 3. So here are the generators, these are absorbed. But then if you go and look at the order 1s, it's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, no, it's got a lot of these little guys in here. Yeah. And then if we had another level, right, so this turned out to be, these were really order 2s, and this is the order 1s here, there'd be a lot more of little order 1s in here. Yeah. Right, so the only way, as you're sort of going down, you know you're on an order 7, you have to hit an order 7, and then you know you'll be in order 8. If you hit anything higher than order 7, you just stop, and you just become that part of, yeah. Yep. Okay? So, this is, you know, I mean, this took decades for people to sort of figure out, and like, how do we classify this? And as you can see, it is still problematic in that these things aren't sort of characteristically similar in size. But, and this is, I think I've basically said all this, but here's the idea, right? So you could do this in another way. You just label the source streams as order equals 1 and then follow them down and do this thing we've just talked about, right? So when two 1s hit each other, that's a 2. If a 1 hits anything greater than a 1, it just gets absorbed. But in general, when two streams of the same order omega hit each other, then now you've got a stream of order omega plus 1. And that's it. And if they're And you can sort of write down like this, right? So the order of the new stream when there's a merge, so an omega 1 stream hits an omega 2, then the order of the thing that the next stream will be the max of them, right? Plus this little Kronecker delta, if we want to write it down, right? So Kronecker delta is 0 if these two numbers are different, and one if they're the same, right? Because it's awesome. This little indicator, right? This is the identity matrix, basically. This little indicator guy. Okay, so if they're the same, right? Same. So max is just, right? Going to be omega. The omega 1 and omega 2 are the same. Then we get a plus 1 here. And if they're not, you just take the max and yeah. So you can write it down like that. So we have a plan, and I kind of wanted to go through it so we make sure we understand it, because then we have to do a bunch of calculations. If we want to then say, you know, what's the area of this basin, this order, you know, 11, 1, given we know what the areas of order 10s and 9s and 8, like, so we have to sort of fit that together. Yeah. Cool beans? Yeah. So, as I said, resolution of data messes with the ordering, right? So if we get finer and finer data, the orders will increase. They should if we really move in. But the relationships are going to be robust. So what you, of course, can do is say, here's my data, right? I have my digital elevation model of a landscape. I find all the streams. And then compute all these things, these orders and so on, and label them. Then you could make that, you can make a coarser version, right? So you could average it, you could make your version worse and see how it changes in that direction. Or you could wait 10 years for technology to get better and go the other way, yeah. I don't know what the full map of the US now would be. USGS, the Geological Society, you can just download stuff, which is cool. Right, so we've discretized the network, we've broken up the little pieces so we can try to understand the architecture. Yeah? Cool. All right. Good. Cool. So there are a couple of things, and so this is Peter's question, really. So now we've got this labeling. So we've got some basin of order omega, then it's going to have within it, right, we're going to label it like this, and this is sort of in keeping with the literature to some extent. There are going to be n streams of order little omega. The way this works is there are more of the little ones, right? So as you go up in order, you have less of them, right? So there's only going to be one stream of the overall basin order. So if it's an order 7 basin, there'll be one of order 7 stream. There'll be more order 6s, more order 5s, more order 4s, right? Okay. And then we'll have area, which is right there's A omega, and we'll have a mainstream length, which will be, right, so we'll start here and we'll travel all the way up. So we're actually going to add together different orders. So maybe it's this, right? So we'd sort of find the longest stream in the whole thing, and that will be it. But we're going to say these things are stream segments, so this will actually be an order, this is an order 3, this is an order 2, and this is an order 1. So we're adding them up, and we'll say stream segment for that. So there's sort of another length that we'll think about here, and we might be interested in how those things scale as well. Yeah, right, so the stream segment, like this is the only part that's order 3, and that's got a length S sub omega. This has a length, it's S sub 3, this is length S sub 2, this is length S sub 1. Okay, yeah. Okay, is that okay? It's okay, maybe okay. Okay, so laws of branching. All right, so this is Horton's laws, right? And so this is Horton. Shum as well, and Strahl are going involved as well. All right. So this is sort of the stated thing. Now, of course, it's a little rougher, and I'll show you examples. But this is the idea that, and it's framed in a way that these numbers are all greater than one. So the numbers, as you go down in order, you get a certain factor, and we're going to write it as R sub n, more streams. Right, so if we have, and this is typically around 4, right? So it's just sort of a funny thing to think about, right? I don't know what it would be in 3 dimensions or so, right? I mean, we have to think about, it's not obvious straight away what that should be if you have a blood network, but you know, what's this, where is this 4-ness coming from? And this is one of these games where people always say everything is the same, and then there's also people saying, well, it's all a little bit different and it matters, and yeah. But you know, roughly, there's a lot of measurements around 4. Yeah, there's stuff sitting here for people to work out. So these are actual numbers, right? You're going to count these up. So these are explicit numbers. when we get to something like stream length, these bars here will indicate averages. I know I often use angle brackets, but it's sort of a bit of a mess in all of this. Anyway, so these are, it might flip to that, but these are averages. So the, and it's framed in a different way, right? This is omega plus one here, right? So 7 and 8, and this might be 8 and 7. So as we go up in order, we get to bigger and bigger streams, right? We're getting to the scale of the basin. So the average size of these guys is, divided by the average size of the ones below in order is, again, some ratio. And the claim is, you know, that this is basically constant. And you can imagine this will be a little bit wrong at the ends, right? And there'll be two reasons. At one end, you've got the smaller streams and you've got issues with resolution and measuring them. And at the other, you've just got one, right? You've got one, and then you don't have enough statistics. And that's a thing to look at as well. Okay, so this is typically around 2. I'll give you that. And then this was also flooding around as well. So there's this one, and this is for area. And this is typically around 4. And actually, from a sort of, if you go through and assume everything is beautiful and connected, this is something we're able to show that these two ratios are actually the same number. So that's something to get to, which is a nice connection. So this is one of these things where we start reducing pieces, but for about 50 years, people weren't, 40 years, people weren't really sure about that. 50 years, yeah. There's this whole literature of people slowly connecting things together. Does it make sense? So these are framed slightly differently, right? Omega plus one omega, omega plus one omega, omega, omega plus one. So these are these laws of the universe sort of statement thing, you know, beautiful things. Physicists come along and say, I can make that happen. And then everyone argues, and it's not really true. So we'll see. Okay, let's look at how this works. So these three laws, we've got these three parameters that we could measure for a landscape. And you might be worried about how that landscape changes, right? I mean, if you had all of, say, Asia, you know, that's a lot of very different kinds of climates and regions, you know, so be a little bit thoughtful about that. But it seems to be reasonable to look at something like, you know, the Mississippi, even so, right? Or the Amazon and so on, right? These are just good, big, coherent basins. All right. So, simple thing, and this is just, you know, marching it out in a very painful way, I suppose, but the number of streams of order 8 is going to be the number of streams of order 7 divided by this number, right? So this is typically around 4. So we're reducing, divided by 16. And eventually we get down to the number of streams of order 1. And if we think about, right, so I like to always do these things. So we start off, we know what this is, right? And then we decrement it a little bit. So we've got a squared here. This is to the power of 1. I don't know how you do this. But this is, you know, if you add these two guys together, then they cancel. So you know you're going to get to N1, and then we need to be down to omega minus 1 by that point, right? Because 1 plus omega minus 1 is omega. And that's what these things are adding up to. I don't know. Right, you have to concentrate sometimes. You know you're decrementing, and this is one of these things where you have to concentrate a little bit. You know, like how many numbers are there between 7 and 4, right? There's always, you have to stop a little bit. Okay, this is a ratio, right? That's with a power, and of course we can write that more usefully as what it really is, which is an exponential. The omega minus 1 is sitting here, so this is e to the minus log n of r, right? This is on the bottom. This is 1 over rn to the omega minus 1, right? So this is rn to the, I know this is a simple thing, but it's just good to do. So we've got this. So this is our power. So then we'd want to write that this number is great. This is greater than 1, so that's sort of an important thing. And we can write that as e to the ln of rn, as you can for any quantity. And then we've got this power, omega minus 1. So this is e to the minus 1 ln of rn. Always good to do this, I think. We like exponentials. Exponentials are groovy. E is a pretty good character. And then, so it's E, this is a positive number, this is a positive number because this was greater than 1, right? So always good to do that. I think that was something, you know, greater than, this is greater than 1, So this is greater than zero. This is greater than zero. You know, I can't sort of say strongly enough how important it is to structure things so that it's clear that there's a negative or whatever involved, right? You really need to do it. If you know you have, if you've written something out and it's got some parameters and so on, and you know kind of rough that this will always be positive, because sure, we could leave this as, you know, 1/Rn. We could do that, right? But it's we're misleading. We're leaving open the. This is a simple example, but you know, obviously, as you get to more and more complicated things, always good to express it in a way that's kind of clear. You know, that this is a negative. This is e to a negative power, right? So it's a decaying thing. Yeah. So this is decaying as we increase through orders, but it's decaying exponentially, right? So boom, 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 really dying away. So same story for area and length, but these are pluses now because it's flipped around, right? So the areas are growing, the lengths are growing, so they're growing exponentially. You can start to see from that how, so number is dropping and the area and length increase, you can start to see how that might give rise to these power law size distributions, right? Because you get big, this is a big growing kind of system, right? Lots of tiny little things, and then they make slightly bigger things, but those bigger things are bigger by a factor and bigger by another factor, and right. So that means that we move through, even though we might move through 10 orders, we'll move through, you know, from the start of the Amazon, like tiny little things in the Amazon, to the overall Amazon. It's a huge range of length scales. Right? So not to be deceived by, you know, having an order 11 basin. That's a huge thing. Right, because you've got 4 to the power of 11 or 4 to the power of 10 and 2 to the power of 10 are the numbers that are really appearing. Yeah. So you should think of, just like you would with earthquakes or whatever, the orders are logarithmic objects, right? Yeah. So order 5 is not just plus 1 relative to order 4. It's a factor bigger. So these are laws of averages. I'll touch on this, a lot of painstaking work to say, well, let's look at the distributions of those things and then connect them, which is a really nice thing to do. Averaging for, the numbers, right, so if you have some basin, you just count all of them. But if we have a basin 7, order 7, another basin of order 7, and then a whole bunch of them, then you can average, right? You could say, well, how many order 1 streams are there in this one, and how many order 1 streams? So you could do that, but you know, it's really averages. Averaging is built in with one basin, right? So this is within a basin, we have averaging of stream lengths and areas. Okay, right? So this gives us a lot of how things fit together, but it doesn't, I think if, and you can see the way people have calculated things over decades, they kind of start with Horton's laws, and then they sort of proceed as if it's a pure branching structure, right? Because you've got an order 7 basin, and now you've got, a Horton ratio of 4 for number. Okay, now we have 4 order 6s, and then they're fed by 5s, and they're fed by 4s, and they're fed by 3s. So you can imagine this sort of branching thing. Okay. There's another piece in here, which is the stream segment lengths, right? So how does this length compared to this length, compared to this length on average. So that's another one, right? And in fact, you can show that these things have to be the same, that the Horton ratio for stream segment length and length. So that's a little problem to work on. It's a small one. It's a nice little one. It means that you understand how these things are fitting together. Very small. So here are some examples, right? Okay, good. And these get you the orders of magnitude. So here's the stream order across here, right, from 1 to 11 in this case, they're all 11s actually. No, actually 10, just 10 here. And so Mississippi, the Nile, and the Amazon. And so this is the number going here. This is area, which is increasing faster. Length doesn't grow quite as fast because, of course, it's, you know, this is length squared, this is area, just length. This is, in this one, this is the mainstream length, this is the stream segment length. So you can see they're scaling very similarly. So the ratio for these guys is the same as the idea. The ratio for this one, which is decreasing, the ratio for this one is increasing. I claim that they're the same. So that's something you get to later on. You see some deviations as you get to the ends, that makes sense, right? Again, sort of just one, you know, some funny things might happen. There could be geological constraints. You only have one example. So the numbers that go into each of these data points, there are many, right? So you're counting a lot here, but then you're averaging over many, 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 but increasingly less, right? This is the number you're averaging over. It's decaying, and it gets to one. There's only one longest basin, longest stream, and largest basin. But the point to look at this is, you know, how we do our power laws, right? Like, hold up a rule, it's not bad, right? It's not bad. It's not doing something totally weird. It's sort of, you know, but it's going to be a little messy measuring it because, you know, maybe you want to get rid of this one, you want to get rid of this one, and yeah. So trying to find some, yes. Yeah. So that's another piece, and I'll show you some stuff later on, but the variance, so if you say the stream segment length things, these actually have an exponential distribution, right? It's not a like peak distribution out here. It's actually, so it really decays. And so you can sort of put all these, you start to put all these things together because eventually you have to add up to like some power law size distribution. So you sort of have all these little things, there's lots of convolutions of distributions, messy, crazy thing. But the variances are huge, yeah. And so they're really masked by this sort of focus on just the average, yeah. And then we saw in the example for the Mississippi, the actual thing, there are some tiny, like one you couldn't even see, right? There's an order 10 you couldn't even see, yeah. Yes, so slope, and I'll show you something with some nice work done the last couple of years. But the slope, there's a very odd, there's sort of this rough empirical connection between slope and the drainage area. But it's such a messy thing. There are a few of these things floating around where it's just like, we just give it some exponent. People have definitely tried to do it. It's... at that larger scales, right, slope sort of is pretty, it's not really there. But in terms of making a model, you need it. Yeah, so that's a whole other thing. I don't think anyone's going close to modeling it at that big scale. And there's also just the real details of erosion are weird, right? So, you know, a particle gets up into the stream, and that's, we talked about a little bit in PUCs, like there's a parallel size distribution for where it lands. There are, you know, specific words. What is it? Not catapulting. What's the right word? Of how these, you know, particles will jump around and how they actually rotate in the fluids. It's also a weird issue. Depending if they're like elongated little boxes, then they tend to rotate in weird ways. It's right. So there are horrible details, but you know, you sort of want to be able to make something that doesn't matter. It's interesting. There are the toy model versions. I don't think there's a really good, super sophisticated, insane model. It's sort of still at the toy model.
We have a couple of hydrodynamic models.
For a channel? For a channel?
And like branching channels.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. Yeah. But like, Right, just to do a really good, right? Yeah. Do that really well, but not a...
Not like the entire country.
Right.
Yes,
it's incredibly important, yeah. I mean, it's such a big deal, right? I mean, and so Houston, I mean, in terms of people thinking about wetlands and those sorts of things, right? I guess in the last 10 years, they've filled in a lot of places that absorbed water. I mean, you know, when you start to build urban areas with concrete, you really change what's possible. But that's, you know, that's another whole bunch of stuff. And we have people here that work on that sort of thing too. You know, subsurface flow is such a big deal, like how much gets stuck underneath. You know, in many ways it's sort of it's not simplistic, but it's sort of the big picture view, right? So these things hold for cardiovascular networks. It's true that measuring these networks is a little messy, right? But you know, you read these papers and there's various approaches to doing this. I think there's one where they took the rat involved and filled it up with plastic and then removed the rat, basically. So then you have your You just have the whole cardiovascular network. The rat has demised. But there's also just getting out. Here are some like sploof, you know, here's some blood networks, and then there's sort of counting it and stuff. And it's a section. So there's a lot of that, right? Here's the pulmonary tree, you know, something like that. But getting, you know, getting the whole system is hard, and it's different places. there are some, yeah. We're going to get to metabolism later on, as I mentioned, which is all connected to this network story, because, you know, you think of organisms, we have this really fundamental thing inside us, which we have networks delivering nutrients, right, and taking them away. We have a couple of different systems for that. But we're three-dimensional things with sources for the energy that then has to be distributed out by a network structure, or is. That's not true for the smallest things. I think insects have, you know, just diffusion and stuff, right? And cells, you know, run on diffusion and so on. But there, you know, certainly, yeah. So the experiment's there to figure out how much oomph an organism has, is things where you can actually try to count up the, like, measure the mitochondria, basically, which usually involves, like, atomizing the organism in question. Sort of little charred remains of a squirrel, and then you separate up the those bits. Yeah. Which is a bit like, you know, taking your food and it has this many carbohydrates and this many quarks and that sort of stuff. And it's like, but it's apple pie, you know, like it's delicious. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, so, but this has been done, and so this takes a while. Not a remote sensing thing, right? This is messy biology. But you know, we should be able to, you would think, eventually with fMRI, right, if it gets, I don't know what the upper limits possibly are for those sorts of things, but we should be able to put an organism in and just go and get a picture of the whole thing, right? Yeah. And then release it back into the wild. There's very confused dreams about cylinders and stuff like that. Okay. So here are some statistics. Wow, it's taking me a while to get through it. This is a paper we're going to come back to about metabolism. It's pretty famous. And so we can just sort of ignore these things. But these are for organisms, a couple of people who hopefully volunteered have had their numbers measured as well. Bit of variation, right? So there's some interesting variation here. And so if we look at, say, this is the branching, this is a branching ratio, right, for the number, not so many, it's somewhat, I said four actually for river networks, it's less than three here. There's some similarity for pigs, and you know, but of course these are just three samples, and these are just three sub networks. Dogs have been involved again. This is not good. But these seem to be, within species, it seems to be pretty similar. And I think the story I came to eventually is that branching networks are good for doing things, right? But in terms of like organisms making them for themselves as you grow, and for us it's like angiogenesis, which is pretty interesting. You have to think about how does a blood network grow, because it actually is this loop structure, right? So how does that keep getting bigger? People have studied that and made models of it. It's an interesting thing. Is that you can have different solutions to that problem, right? So this is a higher branching ratio than us. And you know, rats are a low one, but you are taking you know, a point source, or, you know, like it's a big blob, but it's a sort of a point source in space, and then sending a network out from it. And as long as it branches in a kind of a fractal way, that's going to be okay. As long as it's not too slow, not too fast. But this is easy to implement algorithmically, right, from a growing point of view. It's like just branch now, trees are the same, right, branch. Of course, for trees, we have phyllotaxis, which is a whole beautiful thing, and Fibonacci numbers and stuff. That doesn't seem to be in here. Hmm. Huh. Okay, I should add that. Yeah. Pigs and humans, right? We have some good similarities. Pheromones apparently are similar, which is complicating. Yeah. I guess the organs go this way. Presumably they could go that way, but we're in charge. So thank you for that kidney. What do we have? Hearts, livers? Someone running around with a pig heart? hot valves, and we don't reject them. Sort of ironic that you might then eat some delicious bacon and like mess the valve. Thank you, pig, for both of the things. You delicious, unfortunate animal. Oh, sorry. I never really, that's true, right? I mean, yeah. How did you get that thing blocked up? Well, awkward conversation with Wilbur. Yeah, okay, so. Really a bad thing to make animals talk and, you know, like anthropomorphize. It just really complicates things. There's an old Howard Jones song. Howard Jones? No one? Nothing? 80s? English, but it's something like farmyard favorites, like kids' books, you know, at the table in a different disguise. Some line in there like that, you know, it's really ridiculous. Okay, because you do have to have tricky conversations with kids at some point, right? It's like, okay, so we do it, we're good at it. This is the Santa thing. All right, so here is a bit of a range for these things. This is for actually going back to river network numbers. Bit of a mess. There's no explanation for these exactly. They don't explain how. So they tell us how these things go from level to level. We're not really sure where they come from, you know, why those numbers are the way they are. But they don't actually explain how these things are structured. And that is going to be where I'm going to have to start on Tuesday. We'll get there. We're going to get there. But I just want to tell you a little bit now. The first paper is 68, so Horton is 45, right? So it's 23 years later. It's in Japanese. It has a little English, so you can link to these if you want. There's a little English summary, I think, in all of them, maybe less than a page. But Tokunaga had gotten hold of Horton's work and said, you know, this isn't quite enough, right? Because it doesn't tell you. You know, so I know how long these streams are on average. You know, I could make sort of an average one of these things, but I don't know how many little side streams there are. So, so he really gets at the architecture of this, and if I can just sort of lay out what these things are, and we'll talk about it properly on Tuesday. So, the new parameter, so it's going to be T for Tokunaga, so it's going to be mu. It's a ridiculously another set of labels for orders, could be omega 1, omega 2 if you want, but this is going to be side streams for an order mu, right, that enter as tributaries into an order omega, right, so this could be order 10, and these are the order 7s, and so T, 10, 7, how many order 7 streams on average go into an order 10 side, right, so two 9s make 10. And then there'll be all the 9s that come inside, 8s, or the 7s, or the 6s, or the 8s, and all the 1s. And this tells you, you can get even more detailed if you're in sense after this. But the idea
is this basically this does a better job of telling how these things fit together. Because now we're going to really know, or have an estimate, sort of a sense of how the scaling goes for these side streams. So you're always going to have order mu stream is generated by two order mu minus one, right? So they come together. So these two make three. And then, as I said before, there are two coming in from the side. So let's say for this, if that held true across the landscape on average, and so this is going to be an average quantity, then T32 would be 2. But this could be, you know, 2.34, right? Some average number of streams. Okay, so, and I just want to show you, and we'll get to it again, is that this turns out to have a nice scaling, right? So there's T1, which will be, that's the, if we have an order 8, this is the typical number of order 7s, right? So it's just one below. The point is it just depends on the difference between them. So the number of 4s going into a 7 is on average going to be the same as the number of, so it's a difference of 3, of 7s going into 10s, right? Because it's a fractal thing, scaling thing. So that's a reasonable thing just to say. It's actually true if you look at it, but that's a reasonable thing to say. And then it turns out that these things scale as well in a nice way. So
if we have, say, two streams coming in, side streams, you know, of the next order down, then there's going to be some ratio here, and we have to figure that out, which just increases the number, right? As we go down, as we increase the distance, the difference in order between our stream and these side streams. All right, so this is going to be another law, which is observed, and then we should be able to fit everything together. But this becomes the one that we can start with and then derive everything else from, which is very nice. And Tokunaga figured that out. I remember coming across his work, Don Turcotte, who's a very famous earth scientist. He's now at Davis. He was at Cornell for a long time. He presented some stuff on it, maybe in the 95, 96 at Santa Fe, saying no one knows about this in the US. It's a big deal. And anyway, but people have actually done this for blood networks as well, which is quite detailed work, but they've been able to show that even this holds up there as well. Okay, so that's more stuff about branching networks. I'll put out an assignment, but obviously we have to talk some more. Thank you. Fun times.